is the evening of Tuesday, the 31st of January, 2017. Welcome along, boys and girls. It's today's United Kingdom talk, later than usual. I've been to a funeral today, actually. Was my Uncle Terry's. So it started off in the morning. I got up around about 9 o'clock. And I selected, actually, I did it last night. Last night, I thought I'd better select a few items of clothing to wear. You know, because you don't want to turn up naked to a funeral, do you? Go on, be honest. So I got the black trousers out that I generally wear for all funerals. OK, got these black trousers. Oh, I just try them on just in case. Oh, absolutely no chance whatsoever of being able to do them up. No chance whatsoever. Not even close. Not even breathe in and just about get them close. There was a gap of about that much. So I couldn't wear the trousers. And I thought, oh, well, maybe I've got another black powder or black pair in here somewhere. Nope. No other black trousers at all, just the one pair of black trousers. And in the end, I had to go for some grey trousers that I've worn quite a few times, actually, at various nephews and nieces' weddings and things like that. Now, they still fit. Interestingly enough, I've got a real bit of a problem with trousers and things like that. The fact that you can either do them up, right, and then they hang off your ass and they hang down your legs, or I can't do them up, And they fit round my bum and everywhere else. And I have a real problem with jeans and all that business like that. And yet, these trousers actually seem to fit perfectly at the moment. I don't know if it's I need to go to elasticated waists. That's all there is to it. We need to go to elasticated waists. I can't think of anything else. Now, so I'm wondering, and perhaps you'll be able to help me with this, can I take in my ill-fitting jeans? I mean, they look awful, some of my jeans. I've seen pictures of myself taken with various people, and the top bit's all right. We got the jacket, we got the shirt, the shoes are all right. It's just the legs and the arse. They just hang down because nothing fits. It's awful. Can I take in my pair of perfectly fitting trousers, at least I think they fit perfectly, perfectly fitting trousers, into, say, a dry cleaner's, along with a pair of ill-fitting jeans and say, can you make those like that? Would they be able to do that? Or is that just like so hideously expensive, it would be better to go into a shop and try on loads of different pairs of jeans and that sort of thing until you find something that fits? Now, that picture's stable now, isn't it? I'm pleased about that. Good. Or should I do... What do you reckon? Any ideas on that one? I would appreciate any advice you could give. The ladies will know that. Any of you ladies do a bit of sewing? People don't do sewing anymore, do they? Or knitting or anything like that. They just don't do it. My nan, she would come round my mum's house and she'd be sitting there sewing up socks. Now we just buy a new pair. But when it comes to ill-fitting things, because everything's done to a standard size, isn't it? And I've said to you many times before, I'm sick of going in shops and places and you see the shelves, you know, skinny fit, super slim, slim. Super extra skinny, skinny, skinny. I mean, how does anyone wear this stuff? I've got to tell you, there was a bloke at church on Sunday, right? His son, who's about 16, 17, I suppose, he always wears those skinny jeans, the same as my nephew wears, who's 19, OK? They wear the skinny jeans. Looks good. Looks all right. But this week, his dad had a pair on. Oh, for God's sake, man. What did he look like? And sort of, you know, 50-year-old man in skinny jeans. Oh, come on. You are not going to look like the younger people. I learned that years ago. But I would like something that fits me a bit better. So if you've got any suggestions on that, I'd be very happy to receive those off you, OK? So I went along with the grey trousers and I had a black jacket and a black tie and actually this white shirt that I've gotten today. And I had the address, Woking Cemetery, Woking Crematorium. And she said, my cousin Helen, lovely Helen, said it was Brookwood's Cemetery. OK, so I'm driving along and I saw big sign, Brookwood Cemetery and Military Cemetery this way. On the other side of the sign, I saw a sign that said Woking Crematorium. Oh, here we go. I'm going to end up at the wrong place. I know I am. So first of all, I turned right and I went to Brookwood's Cemetery. It is massive. My word, I've never seen a cemetery like that. But the strange thing is, it apart from all the headstones and all that everywhere, it doesn't actually look like a cemetery. It looks like a common. And it's very, very pleasant. I thought, you know, I could see myself walking around there of an afternoon, you know, perhaps taking sandwiches, sitting on a headstone, you know, with a flask of tea or something like that. I do that at my mum's grave every year. That's not a joke. I do. Every year on my mum's birthday, I take along a flask of tea and a birthday cake, and I sit there with a plate and a knife, and I have cake, and we sit, and I sit there on my own and have a little bit of a chat with my mum. And I could see myself doing that at this Brookwood Cemetery. That I thought to myself, well, it's a bit odd here. You know, there's all like squiggly lines. And it seems to me that it's a large cemetery with various different religions in different sections. I certainly saw a Muslim area. And then over the road, there was a military cemetery. And there were other things there that I didn't quite recognise. I didn't understand the little squiggles on the writing and all that. And, and then fortunately, there was a couple walking towards me. And I said, is this the, is there another cemetery close by? He said, well, yeah, there is. There's one round the corner that's a crematorium. I said, I think that's where I'm supposed to be. He said, is it a Catholic church you're looking for? I said, yes. And he said, oh, yeah, that's the, you'll probably be in the chapel round the corner. So I got back in the car. Went out, went down there, turned right, and sure enough, there was my sister and her husband, Martin, and my nephews, Gary and Jimmy, were waiting there, all smartly dressed. Of course, Jimmy was all done up, weren't he? The hair. Jimmy's got one of those quiffs, you know, when you touch it, it bounces. Doing, doing. The quiff bounces. And very highly polished black shoes. So that was that. I met my cousins. And we were all sort of chatting there, and then Uncle Terry came in the car with the coffin, the hearse. He came in the hearse, and I'd been asked to carry the coffin into the church, and it's not an enormous distance. It really isn't. I mean, you can do the distance in about 15 seconds. 20, maybe 20 seconds. But of course, you go in slowly. So it's about a minute altogether. So it's not a far distance at all. So I was sized up because I think the coffin people, the funeral directors, they look at your height. So I was the same height as my cousin Simon. So we was like at the front, and we're quite close to the back of the hearse. And then they get the coffin out, and you have to put your hands. I've never done it before. You have to put your hands under like that. And they kind of shuffle it along. There's six of us all together, and then we kind of put it up and on our shoulder, and I'm round like that. Just imagine dropping it, dear. Oh, I bet that happens. I absolutely bet that happens. And if you're thinking I'm talking this in a jovial way, there's a reason for that, okay? I'll come to that. If you think I'm talking about coffins and things in a jovial way, there is a reason for that. So I've got one now, and I said, can I hold the handle as well? He said, if you want to. I'm holding on like this, dear. I don't want to drop Terry out. Good old Uncle Terry. Uncle Terry, who was later known, and he named himself as Old Uncle Terry. Bless his heart. And then we sort of walked in and then put it on the thing. And then you slide it forward on this bit of stone. It's not trestles or anything like that. On this bit of stone, because it was a crematorium. And you slide it forward like that, so and then you go and sit down. And then I had the first reading to do, so I did a reading as well, which was a lovely reading from Robin Lewis Stevenson. I've got it here, actually. It's quite nice. It's not a religious thing. Listen. He has achieved success, who has lived well, laughed often and loved much, who has gained the respect of intelligent men and the love of little children, who has filled his niche and accomplished his task, who has left the world better than he found it, who has looked for the best in others and given the best he had, whose life was an inspiration, whose memory is a benediction. And that was it from Robert Louis Stevenson, that was. Then we had him, and then his two sons came up and did a little, talking about Uncle Terry's life and all that business, which they did without crying. I mean, wow. You know, brilliant. I didn't do that at my mother's or my father's funeral. I just couldn't do that sort of thing. But although I played the organ at both of them. So that was very good. And then we had the blessing of the coffin, a little bit of a sermon from the father, from the priest. And then we left. Now, Oh, and then they had some red roses. And of course, his wife, Marion, my Auntie Marion, dear Auntie Marion. And his daughter Helen, sons Tim and Peter, they went up and all put a couple of red roses on the coffin. And then we left. Now, what I liked about the end of it, and of course it's not up to me what to do or anything like that, was something unexpected at that point, because we then left the coffin in the chapel. Now, I've been to cremations before, and generally right at the end, a piece of music plays as selected by either the deceased person or perhaps a member of the family, a hymn maybe, something like that. And then, there's a fly in here now. And then someone pushes a button and this door opens and a coffin slowly slides through it. And I just hate that. I think it's really impersonal when that happens. But what we did is the end of the service came and then we either filed out or filed via the coffin, touched it or kissed it, whatever you want to do, and then left the church and then that was it. We didn't see the coffin going through that awful hole in the wall, which, to be honest, it reminds me of the Generation game conveyor belt when that happens. It's just dreadful. It really is. Of course, you don't get it at a burial because then they lift the thing, take it down, slowly put it into the hole and then put the earth on it. When it's at a cremation, goes through this hole in the wall. It's just horrible. Anyway, they had been asked, apparently Auntie Marion had been asked what she wanted done, and that's what she had decided to do. Have people just walk out, just leave the church, and then the doors were closed, and then anything else like that happened afterwards. So I thought that was really nice. And then we had the wake was at the rugby club. What's the name of the rugby club? But it was in Addleston, which was quite nearby. I went in the car with my cousin Simon. I took Simon because he's over from, he lives in Abu Dhabi. He's very high up in banking. And we got in the car and we read the address on the back of this thing. There's Uncle Terry there. Look, there's Uncle Terry. Okay, there's our Uncle Terry. And that's him with his brother, Martin. There were three of them, actually. Five. There were five. But my nan remarried after her first husband died. So there's my dad and Liam, and then there's Uncle Terry, Auntie Shirley and Uncle Martin, and everyone has gone now except for lovely Uncle Martin. There, that's Uncle Martin, and he lives in Australia, and he lives in the most beautiful place, Cucumber or something like that, I think it's called. Oh, it's just an absolutely stunning place where he lives. Not a massive house, just an ordinary little Australian type house, the sort of thing that you would see on Neighbours or something like that. So we drove and I saw this address. So we drove to this address. I thought, well, we can't find the rugby club anywhere. Surely a rugby club would be down like a dirt track or something like that. You know, usually these places are a little bit run down and we couldn't find it. And then suddenly I realised there were two addresses on here. One for the rugby club and one which was the address of the Undertakers. So we ended up at the Undertakers. Gone the wrong way. Yes, I cannot find my way around. Honestly, I'm terrible finding my way around. So then we got back in the car and, we didn't leave the car. We then turned around and went to the Weybridge Vandals Rugby Club. Vandals, and they are Vandals, which my uncle and indeed his two sons were a member of for many years. And I went in this place. Oh, it was really nice. It wasn't like a rugby club at all. It wasn't dirty. It was spotless. Video screen on the wall and that was showing various photographs of my uncle and members of the family. And of course, as I was just saying about the jeans earlier on, one of me popped up where I'd gone to some family occasion about only about a year ago, actually. And I had the jeans on that don't fit. Well, none of them do. And I thought, my God, that looks awful, awful. So I've got to do something about my jeans at some point. Must do. So we had a little bite to eat. Very nice cheese mozzarella sticks. Yes, please. That's the first time I've seen them at a do. I've never seen them at a wedding or anything like that. So very, very nice. And they were warm. They were still warm. Cheese, not like the ones in McDonald's, dear. No, these were big, thick things. And, you know, you loaded your plate. Well, I had about 10 of them all together. God, I did feel fat after that, I must say. And crisps and little bits like that. I accidentally picked up... Oh, excuse me, I've got an issue here. I accidentally picked up what I thought was a coleslaw sandwich, bit into it and realised it was a prawn one. Oh, no! We don't do fish, dear. Oh! Bleh! Bleh! So I wrapped it in a tissue and placed it on one of the tables so someone else can have a can get the blame for eating a bit of that. And then I had a couple of Danish paste with one with jam and a little one. I mean, it wasn't a lot left by the time I finished, to be honest. And then I came back here, had a little sleep. I got up again to do the show. I thought I'd do a show tonight. And I would have been here a lot earlier had I not gone in the kitchen. And you know, I've got a cat. I've got an elderly cat at the moment, and she's a bit dirty. She's a little bit messy. It's not her fault. Well, it was the worst it's ever been today. She had obviously, I don't understand it. She goes to the wee in the cat tray, but she goes to big toilet on the kitchen floor now. And I put down newspaper, and the more newspaper I put down, I cover an area with newspaper, she don't go on the newspaper. She goes on the kitchen floor, which is like tiles, bumpy tiles, which are, you know, difficult to clean. They're not like flat tiles. They're like slate tiles and are very difficult to clean. And I thought, oh, no. Not only had she gone there, she's got this habit of walking around in circles. So what's happened? And I took a photo. I won't show you the photo. Don't worry. I'm not going to show you the photo. I'm going to send it to my... I'm going to show it to my mate later on. Hopefully, I'm going to see my mate later on. She's obviously gone on the floor and then walked round and round. And she can keep this up for hours. She just walks round and round and round. And she's obviously walked in it and walked round and walked in it and walked round. The mess on the floor, you've never seen anything like it. It's the worst ever. I lost my temper with her. I said, oh, God, Katie, for God's sake. Well, of course, she don't understand what I'm saying. And I feel so bad when I lose my temper with a cat. You know, you shouldn't lose your temper with animals at all. They don't know. You know, she probably did it. She must have done it a long time ago because it was dried on by now. She must have been walking around in that for an hour. And, of course, as she walks around, it's bigger. Oh, Lord. And the smell. So what I'm going to have to do, I think, is cover the entire kitchen floor in newspaper and just put up with it. That's what I'm going to have to do. I don't know what else I can do because the more I extend that little bit of paper, the further out she goes. She doesn't go on the newspaper. It's almost like she sees the newspaper and thinks that I've put it down so that she won't go on that bit. And you can't win. So, and here I am, come up to chat to you. I've got a brand new little camera for for our live shows. You know, those of you watching the recording won't see anything different at all. But the live show, I bought one of these because these are on special offer, right? Usually 90 quid, £55 at the moment. This is the Logitech C920. Okay, sorry, I've got a really itchy ear suddenly. That's the camera that I'm using now. That's the one, if you're watching live, that's the camera you're using now, which is a lot. It really opens up out the back. You can see a lot out the back. Here's the, if you're watching a live show, you're the only people who will see this. Recorded people won't notice this. But here's the old camera. You see how it's much closer. And there's, and the colours are not so well. Mind you, I can adjust those. And there's the new one opening it right up. And it's so much better. And I'm very, very pleased with that. And the reason... This ear has just opened up completely. How marvellous. I can hear everything. How wonderful. I hear everything. And the reason, going back to the beginning there, the reason I can be so humorous about this, the funeral that I went to today with Uncle Terry, is because I cannot tell you on one occasion that I ever met him and he was miserable and serious. Not once. He was always telling jokes, always laughing. If he came to a party, he would make sure that he welcomed everyone, had a good time. He was always having a good time. He would make his own beer in this, in several buckets. He had a shed in the garden and he would make homebrew beer. Does anyone do that? And quite honestly, I don't know why he wasn't poisoned with that years ago. This stuff was strong. My God, it was strong. And the reason, my best memories were of Boxing Day. Because always on a Boxing Day, we would go to either Uncle Terry's or Auntie Shirley's. One of those two houses. Not our house, because we only lived in a small council flat. So we went to either that house or that house. And I think we took turns. I think my mum and dad... kind of, although we couldn't host a part, the Boxing Day things, I think they possibly bought them gifts or something like that to kind of make up for the fact that we couldn't do it. And when it was at Terry's house, they had a lovely, lovely place in Wharton-on-Thames. I mean, it was a beautiful house. It's not a massive place, but at the bottom of the house was the River Thames. I think it was the Thames, or was it River Wey? No, I'm sure it was the Thames. It might have been the Wey. Anyway, let's say it was the Thames, and now and again it would flood. Now, Terry's house was quite high up, so you've got the river down here, and then steps up, and then the house is up here, and it would flood the garden. I don't know, actually, if they ever got completely flooded out, but the water, once I remember, was like that. I mean, the garden was completely covered in this water, and I remember it being like that. They had a fireworks night there once. I think we went to that, and I remember this spinning thing going around. You know the one where you put the nail in the tree, like that? You know that one? And this thing flew off the tree. And I remember Terry cutting up the turkey when we were only children. On the Boxing Day, all the family used to get together, and they were the most marvellous Christmases you could imagine. They really were. They were fantastic. And as I say, the reason I can talk about this in a humorous way is because that is exactly how Uncle Terry would want me to talk about this. So God rest Uncle Terry, and thank you for the wonderful, wonderful times we've had. Really, God rest Uncle Terry. Okay, let's say hello to a few of you this evening who are joining us on the old video. We're live tonight. If you're watching us live, then it's 8:05 on Tuesday the 31st of January 2017, and you're very welcome. If it's another time of the day or another year, incidentally, you're probably watching a recording, okay? Now, if you're watching live, you can call in. There is a local London phone number if you'd like to join us this evening. It's 020-8144-3477, okay? 020-8144-3477 is the live phone-in number. If you have Skype, you can Skype in as well. My Skype-in is United Kingdom Talk. All one word, United Kingdom Talk. Okay, let's say hello to some people who were with us nice and early tonight. Shania's here. She says, hi, Chris. Finally managed to watch a live show at last. Welcome, Shania. Love, you never know when there's a live one. They just appear randomly at random times in your little live, darling. Hello to Adam. Adam's not doing too well at the moment. Adam the plumber has put his back out and he's off work at the moment. I did the same thing. I bet it was a simple thing as well, was it, Adam? I did exactly the same last year around September when I was doing the quiz at the King's Head Theatre. But I haven't sorted that quiz out yet, have I? For tomorrow, let me just write that down. I'm a little bit behind with things. King's Head quiz. I'll have to do that when I finish. King's Head quiz. Yes, last year in September, I was doing my quiz and then I dropped a pen on the floor and I simply went down to pick the pen up. I didn't get to the pen and the pain in my back was unbelievable. Cut a long story short, I had to be helped into the car and I was off work for a few days. I could barely move, but I rung up the doctor. Doctor didn't even want to see me. I told him what had happened. He said, yeah, you've pulled a muscle. He said, don't come in. Very important. Don't get comfortable. Make sure you keep moving or it can seize up completely. And actually, within five days, I was back at work, and within a very short period of time, it all started working right. And now I don't have any problem as well. So I'm just guessing that something simple like that's happened to you, Adam, and I hope you get better soon. All right, my darling. And hello to Anne. Anne's been in hospital as well, haven't you, Anne? Anne, one of our Barry Manilow people. She's got a Barry Manilow grotto in her home. Yes, she has. And Anne says, why were we waiting earlier? Ah, well, on the live show, you get a 5-minute countdown. And the reason for that is, if I was to start chatting, OK, if I was to start chatting and you get halfway in, you think, oh, I wonder what he was saying before that. Now, you don't have to do that. You get a 5-minute countdown, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, with music and pretty graphics and things like that. And then bang, we're on. So that's why you are waiting. Why are we waiting? Why are we waiting? Yes. Thank you, Anne. Hello to Matt Joplin. Hello, Matt. He does his own videos, actually. And he calls it this. He does a little bit of a Mickey take on This Morning. Da, 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 da. You'll have to have a better chest than that if you want to compete with Holly Willoughby, dear. my God, or Pip Schofield. Pip Schofield. Hello to Kiki D, who says, oh, the aliens have landed. The aliens are all very strange and mysterious aliens all over the place. Yes, indeed, Kiki D. All right, hello, Kiki D. Hello to Vectis, who says, how unprofessional. We had a little... Yes, the new camera wasn't working earlier. I think I had it on the wrong... Oh, what do you call it? Ratio wrong... 1280 by 720, that thing, whatever it is. Wrong. Oh, it's one of those words I can't get now. The wrong something or other. Someone will correct me in a minute. Good morning to Rachel Davis, who calls me baldy. Baldy, baldy over there. What's it like to have no hair? Is it hot or is it cold? What's it like to be bald? Now, we used to sing that. We used to sing that to our scout leader, Skip. Hello, Skip. Ted Malden, who's sadly no longer with us. Ted Malden, who was a great, great scout leader. Our scout leader, yes. Baldy, baldy. We used to sing that to him. Now people sing it to me, including you, Rachel. Thank you very much, darling. I shall have to think of a suitable punishment for you next time I see you, dear. Perhaps poison. Next time we have lunch, I shall poison your dinner. I will actually poison your dinner, yes. I was near your way today, Rachel. Woking, I'm sure you know Woking Cemetery. Kiki D says, you sound like a Dalek. What do you mean I sound like a Dalek? Oh, was it echoey? Oh. Hang on a minute. Let's go further up this, because I might be reading old things, old messages here. Does it still sound echoey now, or is it okay? You need to tell me that, really. Let's just turn that down. I'll go to the newer messages rather than read the older ones out. Sorry. Yes, I perhaps I should have read those before I started. Do I sound echoey now? Thank you, not pixels. That's not the word, Rod. Resolution. Thank you. Resolution. Thank you, Shania. Resolution. That was the one. That was the one, yes. Adam says, mind the mirror ball doesn't fall down. Last time you got a new cam, it fell down. Yeah, you're right, aren't you? I might renew the bit of wire that's holding it down there. Has the echo gone now? That was probably something to do with the camera. I hope it was anyway, because I'm not sure. Hang on a minute. Let me try something. I'm just going to speak and you shouldn't hear me. Just check this out. Am I assuming you couldn't hear me there? Huh? I hope so. Otherwise, it means it's coming from there and not here. Oh, it's very, very disappointing. Very, very, very complicated. Let's have a look. Just check that the echo's gone. Has the echo gone? It has gone. Lovely. Ah, the echo was caused by the... I had the sound up too loud there. All right, my darlings. Now, what's going on with Doctor Who? Anyone know what's going on with Doctor Who? Because people, Capaldi, who's 58, not old, who I actually think has been the best Doctor Who since they rebooted it. With David Tennant. I actually wasn't too keen on David Tennant or the other one, the other young one. What's his name? Matt. I thought they overacted. I wasn't keen on them. Peter Capaldi, I thought he was brilliant. But he's going to leave. He's only just started, isn't he? They don't stay very long anymore, do they? How long did Tom Baker and John Pertwee? They seem to be there for years and years. Not this lot. Yes, indeed. Fans were left in today's Super Soraway Daily Mail. And remember, if it's been in the Daily Mail, it must be true. Yes. Fans were left reeling when Peter Capaldi announced his decision to step down as Doctor Who after 3 years in the coveted role. And now Whovians, they are like Fanalos, but obviously not Fanalos. Whovians, who are massive Doctor Who fans, okay, are already looking into the future to predict who may be stepping into his time-travelling shoes. Now, who do you want as Doctor Who? Perhaps you would make a Doctor Who. Can you see anyone in front of you that would make a very good Doctor Who? Anyone? 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 I could be Doctor Who. I could do that. Sarah Jane, why are you looking at me like that? Yes. Exterminate. I will exterminate all the Daleks if I become Doctor Who. That is my promise to you. That is my promise to you. We will exterminate all Daleks. Yes. The three front runners tipped to pick the sonic screwdriver up are James Bond actors Ben We're sure. He wasn't a James Bond actor, was he? Or maybe he's been in James Bond's. He wasn't actually James Bond, was he? No. James Bond actor Ben Whishaw and Rory Kinnear. Now, he's good. Now, is he the son of Roy Kinnear, who used to be in the Dick Emery show? I'm sure he is. And comedian and star of the IT Crowd, Richard Ayoade. I mean, I don't know who's... Well, I don't know Ben Whishaw or Richard Ayoade. I've seen Rory Kinnear. I don't know. Some fans are calling for an actress to take over. With Olivia Colman, Sheridan Smith, Helen Mirren, yes, Helen Mirren, to be the next Time Lord or Lady. Now, who would you like to be Doctor Who? That's the question to you. Perhaps you'd like to talk to me on the phone about it. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. 020-8144-3477. Or you can Skype in on United Kingdom Talk. All right. Use either of those two methods. Or if you're happy to just watch and listen, that's fine as well. You know, no one's forcing you to call in, okay? So who will it be? That is the question. Ah, some pictures here, which unfortunately you can't see. Right, that's Ben Whishaw. Don't recognise him. Oh, not Richard Ayoade. Oh, I can't stand him, dear. Richard Ayoade. He's the one that does some gadget show on Channel 5. Let's see if I can find out. What does he do? Is it the IT Crowd? I don't know. But he gets all these gadgets and tries them out. Have you seen him? Always one of the most annoying people ever. He's got these big, like, permed hair. And big glasses. That one. You know the one I mean? Slightly dark skin. That's Richard Ayoade. I can't even say his name. I'm sorry. So I don't know. Don't know about that one. Roy Reakin here. I recognise him. He hasn't got a doctor's face, has he? No. So I don't know. Out of those three, the one that would look most like a doctor, and I've kind of got an image in my eye how a doctor should look, would be Ben Whishaw. Now, what else has he been in? Layer Cake, Brideshead Revisited, James Bond. No, don't recognise him in James Bond. The Danish Girl and Paddington. Paddington Bear. I don't recognise him at all. Maybe that's what we need. An unrecognised person. That might be an idea, mightn't it? Who do you think should be Doctor Who in the new series? Ah! A good friend, Ray Reynolds, is here this evening. Good evening, Ray. And Ray says, Kai Chris, son of Roy Kinnear, it was. Okay, that was the week that was, and George and Mildred. Yes, so he is the son of Roy Kinnear, who I remembered. I actually fixed Roy Kinnear's telephone. Yes, when I was a BT engineer. Obviously, I cannot give you the exact address. This is, I know, official secrets, dear. Official secrets. But they had a place sort of around the Roehampton area. And I went to fix his phone. And the door opened. And I think a lady came out. I didn't think anything more of it. Anyway, so I proved... I tested the wires. And the fault appeared to leave the house and be... The next place to test it would be at the top of a pole. So I pulled the ladders off the top of my little yellow British Telecom van. Pulled the ladder off and shoved it up a pole. And as I was putting my safety belt on, because you have this safety belt, you see, and you climb up the ladder, and then when you get to the top of the pole, you can either climb up without the safety belt on or put the belt around it and then climb up. So if you slip, you know, the belt will hold you. Although I'm not so sure with this extra weight that I'm carrying at the moment, but it should hold you, okay? So as I put the ladder up, this bloke's come, and I was having my back to him. He said, you got it up there, mate. And I turned around, and it was Roy Kinnear. Roy Kinnear, wow. One of the funniest people ever on the telly. He was. And I said, yeah, I've got to go up there. He said, oh, sod that, mate. I'd leave the effing thing alone and go home. So he was really nice. So it is his son. Oh, thank you very much. Yes, I like that. Rachel says, Barry Manilow should be the new Doctor Who. He can travel time and start over. I'm liking that. Do you think Barry Manilow would accept the thing of Doctor Who? Has Barry Manilow been in any films or done any acting? Perhaps you can advise me on that. Incidentally, this is your last day to check out the January Ballyhoo Manilow picture. The February one, which cannot be revealed until tomorrow, will be revealed on the next show, on this station, only on this programme. Now, I've saved something, actually. You don't want to go anywhere, OK? That's all I'm telling you. I've got something to show you. No flesh, dear. I've got something to show you a little bit later on in the show. I didn't want to say at the beginning of the show, because at the beginning of the show, what we get is quick visitors. You know, they quickly flick on. Nah, I don't like that. So this isn't for them. This is for you, regular, loyal viewers and listeners. That's coming up. So don't go anywhere. OK, don't go anywhere. Just for you. Anne says, yes, he was in Copacabana, the TV movie. He played the lead Tony Stark. Oh, really? Well, I didn't know that. Well, I haven't seen that. Shock horror. The Manilow people are going, what? Chris Reardon hasn't seen Copacabana. No, I haven't. Right, write it down. Copacabana. In fact, no, why write it down when you can order it now? One moment, please. Amazon. Sorry, you don't mind if I do a little bit of internet shopping while I'm chatting to you, do you? So professional. Copacabana. One moment, please. Aha. Oh, no, that's the album. Oh, no. OK, film. Copacabana DVD. DVD. You want to buy DVD? Copacabana DVD. Oh, region one. That's no good to me. Region one. No. Oh, dear. I can only find it on region one, which I don't think my thing will play. £177? What planet are they on? Well, I'm a Barry Manilow fan, but I ain't paying £177 for a film. Seriously? God's sake, man. What's this? Copacabana with Groucho Marx. Is that the one? No, I don't think it is. Oh, I'm paying £177 for a DVD. Are they serious? What planet are they on? God's sake, man. Can you find that for me, Rachel? See if you can find that one for me. OK. Vectis, no guessing, Vectis. No guessing, dear. Dear me. Can you have a look at that for me, please? The hair on spray is still here. The hair on spray is still here, Kiki D. Don't worry, darling. It's just what I've got to do is do it outside. It's been a bit cold because it blooming stinks, this stuff. I'm going to do that one day before. I'm a bit worried it's going to start running down my face. Hair on spray to sort out the baldness. That's what we need, yes. Adam says, Chris Reardon as Doctor Who. Yes, I could play a Doctor Who. I could go around deleting people. Oh, no, he doesn't do that. Who does the deleting people? Oh, that's the Cybermen, isn't it? Delete, 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 delete. Dear me. Helen Mirren sounds good. I think so as well, Rachel. I'd like Helen Mirren to play him. Or actually, oh, what's her name? She does the comedy show and she was a Doctor Who sidekick for a while. Oh, she's very, very funny. And she does Nan. All right. You come up to see me. Who does Nan? You come up to see me. Ow, ow. And she's got a potty mouth. No, because she keeps swearing all the time. Who does that? What's her name? Someone tell me, please. Yes. So thank you very much. Shania says she couldn't hear me at all. Really? I haven't been talking to myself again, have I? I do that quite a lot, to be honest. I can't lie to you. I spend most of my life sitting here talking to myself. Thank you very much. Rachel is looking for me now. So there we are. Rachel's looking for us now. Good. So we got the sound sorted. We got the picture sorted. We're not doing too well today, are we? Never mind. That's a shame. But other people to play Doctor Who? I'm just thinking now. I quite like the girl who was her sidekick once. Can't remember. How about Dawn French? Dawn French. She'd be good at it, wouldn't she? She'd be a laugh a minute. Because you've got to have humour in Doctor Who. It can't be all serious. Dawn French. I think she'd make a good female Doctor Who. I'm just trying to think who the name of the lady who used to be our sidekick is. It's not coming to me. No. Perhaps someone can remember that. Hang on. Sidekicks of Doctor Who, perhaps. Who does Nan TV? Oh, I don't know. That's a really awkward question. Who does Nan? Nan on BBC. Who does Nan on BBC? Catherine Tate. There we go. Catherine Tate. She would be an excellent Doctor Who. A totally and utterly excellent Doctor Who. And I am unanimous on that. She totally would be an excellent Doctor Who, don't you think? Just a suggestion there. So there's my few suggestions of female Doctor Who. Male Doctor Who, I don't know really. No, I can't think. I would like an older actor. I always think Doctor Who should be played by someone a bit older, you know. Perhaps as old as me. Yes. Minimum of 54 years. Next week anyway, 54. All right. So there we are. Thank you very much to Ray Reynolds. I must say, Ray, he bought me in a early birthday present last night, along with Johnny Key. Great big box. And it says Dell on the side. And I was just saying to him, oh, but it was a very light box. And I said, you do realise the disappointment on my face if this actually turns out not to be a Dell computer. I will be so disappointed if it's not a Dell computer. So I'm looking forward and I shall open the box live on this programme either Friday or either Sunday or Monday next week, all right? I've got a nice big box, a little wrapped up gift and all sorts of things. So thank you very much to Ray and Mr. Johnny Key to that. I do appreciate that. And we had a great karaoke last night. We've got a new group of people coming in now, actually. And they're all really nice. A couple of drag queens come along, out of drag, incidentally. But that's building as well. That's 90. And my sandwiches from Maureen were upgraded to a banana as well. Not only did I get the sandwiches and a small bar of chocolate. Oh, and Ray, I'm going to make a little request to you, Ray. Please don't bring me in those bars of chocolate anymore. I really, really appreciate them, but I'm trying to lose a bit of weight. And once I'm not someone who can take off a couple of squares, put it in my bag, and then put it away for a week. Can't do that. No. It all goes very, very rapidly down into my gullet. So please, I must request, Ray, that you don't buy me any more chocolate, my darling. But thank you very much. What I did after you left, I think I had one. I mean, even then I had three rows. And then, great, this is massive. I haven't got anything here that's that size. Actually, it's bigger than that. Yeah, that'd do. These large chocolates are about that big. They're about that big, these large chocolates. They're massive. And even then I had three rows of it. And then I started handing it round. I hope you're not too disappointed with me for handing it round there, right? Okay, but please don't buy me any chocolate. Although it is delicious and I'll probably be disappointed if you don't buy me any now. All right. Adam says, there are lots of sins in chocolate. Yeah, I can well imagine it. God knows how many sins there would be, Adam, in that particular bar of chocolate. Actually, Adam, do you want to call in? I want to ask you about your back. We need to find out what's wrong with your back, darling. Hello to Deirdre, who's with us today. All right. You've got VHS is no good to me, I'm afraid, Anne. I can't play VHS anymore. I haven't got VHS anymore. I've got a DVD thing and I've got a Blu-ray player, but I don't think it's available. Maybe I'll try eBay. eBay might have it, mightn't they? The Barry Manilow Copacabana. Has anyone got it? Was it ever out on DVD? That's a good question, isn't it? Yeah, might not have been out on DVD. All right. 020-8144-3477 if you'd like to call tonight, okay? Or use the Skype on United Kingdom Talk. Now, let me close that for you. We were talking about funerals and things like that earlier. Some people are buried. Some people are cremated. Well, check this article today in this evening, this morning's Super Soraway Daily Mail. This is Dewley Garden's new resting place. And there's a picture of just basically flowers and a bit of marble at the front there, right in front of me. Looks like a little bit of a shopping centre. You know that marble floor and the marble walls and all that. This is Judy Garland's new resting place in Hollywood after her remains were moved from New York to be with her three children. And I thought to myself, why would you want to move anyone's remains? I hope they don't do that to me, dear. You know, once I'm resting, I don't want to be moved and shoved around all over the place, do I? Rude, that's what it is. Would you like to be moved like that? Poor old Judy Garland. Leave her there. I hope they remembered her red ruby red slippers as well. Adam's on the phone. Hello, Adam.
Good evening, Mr. Reardon. How are you?
Bonjour. Now, what was it with the sound earlier? I don't understand what was wrong with the sound. What did you hear?
It sounded like you were talking through a drain pipe.
And then what made it better?
I don't know. You must have done something. Did you have your microphone plugged in or?
Did I say, let me try this, and then it became better? Don't remember. Doesn't matter. I can listen back to the recording and see if I can find it.
You'll see in the beginning, it sounded like a drain pipe.
Yeah. But I've got a lovely new little camera here. It's brilliant.
It
it's
is.
So much better.
Yes. Now, I must warn you, with new cameras, be careful of mirror balls falling.
Oh, yes. Do be careful. That happened to me, didn't you? Remember that? Was it around,
I do.
It was a Christmas show, wasn't it?
It was indeed, actually. Yes.
What year was that?
That was 2000 and... 14, I think.
Was it really? Blimey,
I think it was.
As long ago
you were,
as that.
You were demonstrating your latest camera, and as you pulled up the box came up and the ball fell down.
You are a regular viewer, Adam. You really are, my darling.
I am. I've watched hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of them.
God, you must be off your rocker,
mate. I'm still
taking
therapy for it.
Now, tell us what you've done to your back.
I have no idea, Chris, but I'm calling the doctor out tomorrow because, as you know, Sean is a nurse.
Who's Sean?
And my partner.
Okay.
And as you know, I've had back problems in the past.
Yes.
I've put it out before.
Yes.
And I went to bed on Sunday night, ready for work on Monday morning. And basically, this is where I've been ever since. I've managed to get up a few times and try and exercise it. But every time, it just spasms and I have to more or less dive back into bed.
Very important not to get comfortable. That's what my doctor said when I had it. It's really bad if you sit there and do nothing, knowing that if you move, it's going to hurt. You've got to keep the moving. You must keep moving.
Oh, yeah. I do try and get up every sort of every regular intervals to try and, sort it out.
When did this come on? Did you wake up like it, or were you doing something or what?
No, I just literally went to bed on the Sunday evening, ready for work on Monday morning.
Yeah.
And woke up Monday morning, went to get out of bed and just literally screamed in pain, you know.
Yes.
And I knew what had happened because I'd had it before.
Right.
My back started spasming and couldn't move, basically.
Gosh. Oh, that's awful. Back pain is awful. Do you do pills or do you just sit it out?
Well, I've had some anti-inflammatories to try and take the swelling down.
And did anything
and
happen?
Some other tablets, and they're not really doing much, so I'm going to call the doctor out tomorrow.
Well, I found that those anti... You take these pills on the advice of people, and they don't seem to do anything. They don't do anything at all. Now, I think the doctor's going to tell you you've pulled a muscle and he's not going to want to see you.
No, probably not, but I'll have the doctor come out and see me.
It's worth a go, though, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, definitely, yeah.
Yeah, give it a go.
And but the cat's been keeping me company, as you've seen in the little picture I saw with you.
Oh. How old is your cat again now?
He is around about 12, 13.
Is he? Did you see the beginning of the show when I told you about Katie tonight?
Yes, bless her.
Oh, my Lord. I tell you what, I will forward you the picture of the kitchen floor.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to show it on there. I'll forward it to
you.
And I've never seen so much mess in all my life.
Bless her.
She must have been walking around in that for ages.
Yeah, it's very difficult, isn't it, at times, you have that sort of situation.
It wasn't a case of getting a bit of kitchen mop, picking it up. No. I had to mop it about three times. Oh, the mess.
See, I've got a very similar problem with Afro, actually.
You've got a problem with yours?
Yeah, he's now starting to go, starting to use the front door as a toilet.
Oh.
Just by the front door. He's never been an outdoor cat. He's always been an indoor cat.
Right.
But
he might
want to
go out.
What it is.
Have you got a garden?
No. In a flat, so in a little block of flats. So right. Unfortunately, you know, there's a sort of public area outside, and he sort of goes out every now and then,
right,
has a sniff around, and then runs back in. But he's always been an indoor cat.
Yeah.
And I'm going to take the advice of Claire, actually, who's one of your viewers, and I'm going to try and put his food bowl where he's been using the front door area as a toilet, because apparently cats won't do that if their food's there.
Oh, really? Well, I mean, you wouldn't want the foot... I mean, see, my cat, she does it near the litter tray. And I don't really want to put her food near her own litter tray. That's not.
No,
good,
no, of course
really?
Not.
But I'm going to.
Is it a new litter tray or is it a fairly old one?
No, same litter tray. No, I have no choice but to have to cover almost all the. I'll cover the entire area where she is now in paper. But my guess is she'll just go onto another bit where there's no paper. It's a weird thing. I mean, on the very rare occasion she does go on the paper, it's simply then a case of picking up the paper, because don't we on it? It's only number twos. Mm-hmm. Isn't it funny? I don't understand her, dear. But she is.
Maybe,
she's losing
maybe
the
if
plot
you try getting her a new litter tray that hasn't got any scent on it.
Tried that. I've tried that because the vet told me get another litter tray. She might use one for one and one for the other. She can go near the new one. Wouldn't touch it.
No, strange, isn't it?
Well,
it can be strange, but I mean, as you say, it's, you know, it's her age.
Yeah,
you know, it's to be expected with elderly girls.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I feel sorry for you, darling. I hope your back gets better very soon. All right.
Yep.
No money coming in from work, dear.
Sorry.
You got no money coming in from work?
No, I haven't. No.
Oh.
No, I'm poor and broken. So
poor. You're just like me. Poor, lovey. Poor.
Please set up a GoFundMe account. You know, buy a Christmas.
Do you know how many people are setting up these GoFundMe projects?
I know.
Honestly, the trouble is, you know, which ones do you believe and which ones are lying?
Well, I'll tell you one to believe in, actually, Chris. And you've promoted it before, if I may, just give it a little plug before I go. UK Homes for Heroes.
Oh yes, that sounds like a normal one to me.
Yeah, UK Homes for Heroes. In fact, Michelle was probably watching because I invited her, and I did see her. She's one of the founders along with Jimmy Dukes. Right. Jimmy Dukes is the Pearly King of Pearly King, and Michelle is the Pearly Queen, and that's their charity. UK Homes for Heroes. They go out every Wednesday night to Waterloo. And they feed the homeless on the streets, and they also try and rehouse the ex-service personnel that have got PTSD and have ended up on the streets of the UK as well.
Mm. Yeah,
there's quite a few outreach teams throughout the UK, so there's a good little charity to go on to if people want to.
An excellent charity. All right, Adam. Well, thanks for calling
Thank you, Chris.
Nice to chat to you. Get well soon, my friend. All right.
Thank you, Chris.
Cheerio. Adam the plumber there, boys and girls. If you've ever want any plumbing, that's the man to go to, because you won't be ripped off. I promise you that. There's no call-out charge. You'll just be charged a very reasonable rate. He's done jobs for a lot of my friends now, I tell you. And he will do a good job and he won't rip you off. All right, I promise you. Thank you, Rachel. She sent me something on Amazon now. Let's have a quick look at that. Let's have a look. That looks like it's going to be a Region 1. Click to open expanded view. Let's have a look. I'll look at that. Actually, I'll look at that at another point. All right, because that's in America, so I'm guessing that's going to be a region one, which is unfortunately just the United States. I don't think I'm going to be about to play that. Ray Reynolds is very, very, very impressed by the two camera effect. There you go, Ray. There it is again for you, my darling. The two camera effect. Although I'm looking at one at the moment. I'm not quite sure how it all works. I know what you're thinking, Ray. No, we can't use this at the karaoke, unfortunately, because that involves using it would involve using another computer, running cameras. I'd have to get there at 5 o'clock in the afternoon to set it all up, unfortunately, Ray. Thank you, Ray. Anne says the DVD is not in a Manolo shop either. Aha! Kiki D says the Copacabana whole film is on YouTube. Thank you, Kiki D. I'll check that out. Because the wonderful thing I can do with my mobile phone, I've got this Apple TV, which is just a little box, really, which my friend bought me, Ronnie bought me that years ago. But I can have something on my... that is connected to the TV. So this little black box connected to the TV. But I can have something on my iPhone, like a YouTube video or something like that, and then push a couple of buttons, and then it goes to the Apple thing and comes on the big telly. So I will be able to watch that on the big telly. Thank you very much for that, Kiki D. I'll check that, all right? Ah, Ray says I can copy a VHS. That's all right, Ray. Thank you. Hello to Jerry Miller, who's with us today. Not on eBay, apparently. Copacabana, not on eBay either. All right. Anyone else want to call in this evening, boys and girls? Nice and quickly, my darlings, because we'll be disappearing soon. We'll be chatting away for an hour, and I don't want to bore you too much. But first, something has arrived in the post. Actually, it's not arrived in the post. My sister bought these down for me today, and I've been promising these to you for our very loyal viewers. You'll need a pen next, okay? You're going to need a pen, okay? These are the United Kingdom Talk mugs available to you. Ready? Here it is. They are in shiny, nice and shiny. Check this out. Like, United Kingdom Talk mugs with a little picture of me there, lovies. I have just 20 of these. That's all there is. I don't know if that's going to work. Well, do you want me to sign them as well? I will sign the bottom of them as well. I'll sign them if my black pen's still working. I'll get a black pen. Now, do you want one of these? If you want one of these, you can have one. You're going to have to send me your address by email, okay? Send me your address by email and I'll get one of these out to you within a week, okay? I've only got 20 and I waited until the end of the show because by the end of the show, we've only got the... I can't get it back in a bloody box now. Hang on a minute. How did she... Oh, that's it. It will arrive in a little box like that, okay? Hopefully it won't get smashed in the post. If it does, there isn't a replacement one. How much am I going to charge you? Nothing. Nothing. Okay? So if you want one of these, you need to email me your postal address. And you need to send the email to chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. You need to send me your postal address to chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. Now, please, a request. Do not tell your friends, okay? Because there are only 20, and I wanted to keep these for the people that are sort of loyalists, who have been, how can I put it, supporters. You know, because those of you still here at the moment, I'm fully aware how much you support what I do. You know, sometimes I get, oh, I don't know if I should be doing this anymore. And then you get an email from nowhere, generally Wendy, actually, who brings you up again and you carry on doing it. Do you know what I mean? But if you're still here at this time, then you're a proper viewer, supporter of the show. Whether you're watching live or the recording, if you've got to this point, I know that you're a loyal person. And I'd like you to keep it to yourself. Don't tell anyone. Don't tell anyone, oh, he's giving away mugs. This is just for you, okay? Just for you. So if you want one of these, send me your postal address and email me your postal address, it doesn't have to be your house, obviously, or an address where I could send it to chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk, chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk, and I will send you one of those in the post. All right? I told you I'd get them done, didn't I? I know, it'd take a little bit more than usual, but that's where you need to send your email address. Don't do it on a Facebook message, it might get lost. Do it on an email, chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. Anne says, I play Region 1 on my computer. Oh, well, I've never played a DVD in the computer. I've got a DVD player downstairs connected to the TV. I'm pretty sure it won't play American ones. So thank you for that one. Okay. Good. What I might do, actually, to save on postage is going to be a little bit of a problem, to be honest. What I might do is, those of you that are close by, I might bring them to you. Okay. A special delivery. Wouldn't that be fabulous? All right. So they're available now. Right. Let's do today's birthdays and then we're going to disappear today. Oh, hello to Graham. Hello, Graham. All right, Graham. Who says, on the subject of dying, I just wanted to say, I want to leave my body for science to do. Well, do you think they'd be interested? No. No, Graham, I've seen sort of a rough shape of your body hanging in the middle of all those clothes, dear, and I'm not completely convinced they would be interested in your body. Just a little bit of a friendly advice there. Okay, my loves? Thank you, Graham. All right, let's do today's birthdays, boys and girls. How many have we got today? Let's have a look. Bring those up. Yes, happy birthday to Chai. Oh, a very, very well-known karaoke singer who does all the circuit. Happy birthday, Chai, my good friend. He's probably away. He does a lot of holidays. He's always abroad somewhere. Happy birthday, Chai. Happy birthday to Gary Cooper, another karaoke man, 46 years old today. Happy birthday, Gary. Happy birthday today to Ian Watson, to Lily George, 52 today. To Lily George. Are you Fag Ashlil? I'm not sure if you're Fag Ashlil or not. Lily George. Is Lily George Fag Ashlil? I think she probably is. If it's so, where have you been, Fag Ashlil? Do try and keep in contact, dear. Man. All right. Happy birthday to Lily George, who might be Fag Ashlil. Happy birthday to Johnathan Harborne. Happy birthday, sir. To Colin Edwards. Are you the Colin Edwards who does the radio stuff? I'm sure you are. Happy birthday, Colin. Long time no see. And happy birthday today to the lovely Christina Delaney, who used to come along to our bingo nights when I was at the Golden Lion. Not that Golden Lion, the Golden Lion in King's Cross. So happy birthday to you all. Here comes the song, gang, all right? Happy birthday, happy birthday to you. Enjoy what is the left for your birthday. Just one more lot of comments. Adam says you can get unlocked codes for DVDs. I don't know how that works. You're talking to someone who's not very good at technology, as you well know. Although I'm quite pleased with myself. I managed to get the camera working today. Enjoy the rest of your Tuesday, boys and girls. I'm not working tonight, but if you want a karaoke this evening, you can join Ben Parker, who's hosting karaoke tonight at the Golden Lion in Camden Town. That's starting actually very soon, at about 9 o'clock, all right? Apart from that, thanks for watching.